Let us pray. Lord, I thank you this morning. I come into this church with thankfulness in my heart, Lord, that we are able to gather in your house here, a house provided by your hand, Lord, and sing praises to you and worship you this morning. Lord, we gather together to hear a word from you. Lord, this is all about you today. So, Lord, open up our hearts and our minds to be willing to receive what it is that you have for us. Lord, you didn't call us here just to come together and have a good time. You called us together for instruction. Father, that we may go out and serve this community and others see the love of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you. Jesus. Our lesson this morning is entitled Complete Faith, based on the scripture, the book of James, chapter 2, verses 14 through 26. Our key verse this morning, in the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. James 2, verse 17. Our lesson focus this morning is faith must be contemplated by action. Tongue twister. Do we have any announcements this morning? Do no announcements. We'll take up tithes and offering, and class will begin.
Good morning. Now I know that it seems like it's only been a week since I taught Sunday school, but remember it was actually last month. So, well, it was. So anyway, for I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. Let us pray. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for another beautiful day, for the gift of life and the blessings of life, Lord. And we thank you for forgiving us of our many, many sins. Lord, I ask you to give your people ears to hear and hearts to receive the words you have for them this day. In your holy name I pray. Amen. Well, as Warren says, our quarterly tells us that today's lesson is entitled Complete Faith. And of course, we're continuing the study of the book of James, which we've been studying this entire quarter. And in researching for this lesson, I came across some very interesting information. Now, if you just take the quarterly and you take what they give you and stick with it, sometimes you don't find out everything you need to find out. And so in doing a little research, it came up about Martin Luther, the founder of the Protestant movement, and Martin Luther and his opinion of James and several other books of the Bible. And I want to share that with you, but first let me give you a little background on Martin Luther in case you've already forgotten that part that you studied in your Bible studies. So Martin Luther was born November 10th, 1483. He was a German priest, a theologian, an author, a hymn writer, professor, and an Augustinian friar. Luther was the seminal figure of the Protestant Reformation, and his theological beliefs formed the basis of Lutheranism. And he is regarded as one of the most influential figures in Western and Christian history. Now, Luther was ordained a Catholic priest in 1507. and he came to reject several teachings and practices in the Roman Catholic Church. In particular, he disputed the view of indulgences. Now, indulgences could be purchased from the church. They could be purchased to forgive your sins. They could be purchased to forgive your dead relative's sins. They could be purchased for any reason that you had extra money and wanted to give it to the church so that they could keep it. So, Luther attempted to resolve these differences amicably, first proposing an academic discussion of the practice and an effigy of indulgences in his thesis 95, which he authored in 1517. That didn't go over very well. In 1520, Pope Leo X demanded that Luther denounce all of his writings, and when Luther refused, he was excommunicated as a Catholic priest in 1521. Later that year, Roman Emperor Charles V condemned Luther as an outlaw. And when Luther died in 1546, the excommunication by the Catholic Church was still in effect. Luther taught that salvation and consequently eternal life are not earned by good deeds. Rather, they are received only as a free gift of God's grace through the believer's faith in Jesus Christ, who is the sole redeemer from sin. Luther's theology challenged the authority and the office of the Pope by teaching that the Bible is the only source of divinely revealed knowledge and considered all baptized Christians to be a holy priesthood. Luther's translation of the Bible into German from Latin made the Bible vastly more accessible to the laity, which had a tremendous impact on both the church and German culture. It fostered the development of a standard version of the German language. It added several principles to the art of translation and influenced the writings of an English translation, the Tyndale Bible. His hymns actually influenced the development of singing in the Protestant churches. Now, from 1510 to 1520, Luther lectured on the Psalms and the book of Hebrews and Romans and Galatians. And as he studied these portions of the Bible, he came to view the use of terms such as penitence and righteousness by the Catholic Church in a completely new way. He became convinced that the church, the Roman Catholic Church, was corrupt in its ways, and it had lost sight of what he saw as several of the central truths of Christianity. The most important for Luther was the doctrine of justification, God's act of declaring a sinner righteous by faith alone through God's grace. He began to teach that salvation or redemption is a gift of God's grace, attainable only through faith in Jesus as the Messiah. This one and firm rock, which we call the doctrine of justification, he writes, is the chief article of the whole Christian doctrine, which comprehends the understanding of all godliness. Now, Luther came to understand justification as entirely the work of God. Against the teachings of his day that the righteous acts of believers are performed in cooperation with God, Luther wrote that Christians receive such righteousness entirely from outside themselves, that righteousness not only comes from Christ, but is actually the righteousness of Christ, imputed to Christians rather than infused into them through their faith. That is why faith alone makes someone just and fulfills the law, he writes. Faith is that which brings the Holy Spirit through the merits of Christ. Faith, for Luther, was a gift from God. The experience of being justified by faith was as though he had been born again. Luther wrote that Jesus Christ, our God and Lord, died for our sins and was raised again for our justification. He alone is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, and God has laid on him the iniquity of us all. All have sinned and are justly and justified freely without their works or merits, but by his grace, through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ, in his blood. Power in the blood. This is necessary to believe. This cannot be acquired or grasped by any work, law, or merit. Therefore, it is clear and certain that this faith alone justifies us. Nothing of this article can be yielded or surrendered, even though heaven and earth and everything else fails. Now, Luther famously took issue with the book of James, which we're studying now. He didn't think it expressed the nature of God. It appeared to contradict Paul's statements about justification by faith, and it didn't directly mention Christ. To quote Martin Luther, "Therefore, St. James' epistle is really an epistle of straw compared to these others, for it has nothing of the nature of the gospel about it." It's often been said that Luther was actually opposed to the book of James being included in the Bible. But while Protestant churches embraced many of Luther's ideas and teaching, our Bibles clearly still include the book of James today. So is it true? Did the great reformer really believe that this important book didn't belong in the Bible? Now, while Luther was openly critical of James and wondered whether the epistle belonged, he never formally proposed that it should be removed. If you only look at the direct mentions of Christ by name, Martin Luther is right. The book of James doesn't appear to have much to do with Jesus. It only mentions him twice in passing. Once in James 1:1, a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ, and once in James 2, believers in our glorious Lord Christ Jesus. In spite of that, James makes numerous references to Christ's teachings, and there are places where he likely uses the Lord to refer to Christ. Even without the more overt references, James' epistle reflects the heart of Jesus. Jesus frequently alludes to the importance of caring for the poor. He even goes so far as to suggest that by serving the poor, we are serving God. And he links our concern for the poor to our salvation. See the parable of the sheep and the goats in Matthew 25. Perhaps this is why James wrote things like this: "Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world." James 1:27. Luther's biggest issue with the book of James was that it appeared to contradict the writings of Paul, and it seemed to oppose the doctrine of justification by faith alone, which was a central text of the Protestant movement. The Catholicism of Martin Luther's time was hyper-focused on the value of works. But Luther found that the Scriptures repeatedly asserts we are to be saved through faith in Jesus Christ, not by anything we do. And yet the book of James says that faith without works is dead. So what are we supposed to do with that? Was Luther wrong? Do we need works to be saved? Or is James contradicting Peter and other important passages about the Christian faith? The reality is that James is not suggesting in any way that works lead to our salvation. It is a result of our salvation. Jesus uses the metaphor of trees and fruit to capture a similar idea. If we claim to have faith in Jesus Christ, but our lives bear no evidence of that, it's like claiming we have good fruit, but all we produce is rotten. And he makes it clear what happens to trees with rotten fruit. By their fruits we will know them. Do people pick grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Just so, every good tree bears good fruit, and a rotten tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a rotten tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. So by their fruits you will know them. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the ones who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not drive out demons in your name? Did we not do mighty deeds in your name? Then I will declare to them solemnly, I never knew you. Depart from me, you evildoers. Martin Luther called the church to renew its focus on Christ. And as a part of that, he placed greater emphasis on the books of the Bible that most magnify the glory of Christ. That is why Luther had strong reservations about James' inclusion in the biblical canon. But that is also exactly why it has stayed there for centuries. James constantly echoes Christ's own words and teaching. And so now, with a little background, we'll move into the scriptures for today. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or a sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by my deeds. You believe that there is one God. Good. Even the demons believe that, and they shudder. You foolish person, do you want evidence that faith without deeds is useless? Was not our father Abraham considered righteous for what he did when he offered his son Isaac on the altar? You see that his faith and his actions were working together, and his faith was made complete by what he did. And the scripture was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, and he was called God's friend. You see that a person that is considered righteous by what they do, not by faith alone. In the same way, was not even Rahab, the prostitute, considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in a different direction? As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without deeds is dead. So, James takes up the topic of work in detail in the second part of chapter 2 when discussing work. He invariably uses the plural works, the Greek word egra, rather than the singular word in Greek egron. This leads some to suppose that James uses works, the plural, to mean something different from work, the singular. However, the singular and the plural forms of the word have some of the same meanings. James is describing any kind of work, from works of kindness, such as giving food to someone who is hungry, to on-the-job work, such as increasing the sustainable yield of rice. His use of the plural shows that he expects Christians' work to be continual. James focuses on works has led to deep controversy about his letter. As I mentioned earlier, Luther famously disliked James because of the way he read it. He considered James to be a contradiction of Galatians 2:16. A person is justified not by works of the law, but through the faith in Jesus Christ. Other leaders of the Protestant Reformation did not share this view. Although we cannot go into a long debate about Luther and the book of James here, we can inquire briefly whether James's emphasis on works is at odds with the Protestant rejection of justification of works. So what does James himself have to say? James 2:14 is arguably the centerpiece of his argument. So we will consider this section before moving on. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? James bluntly answers his own question by stating, so faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. As dead, he notes in a carefully chosen example, as someone who is desperate in need of food, who receives only empty words of well-wishing from his neighbor. James takes it for granted that believing in Christ, trusting in God, will move you to feel compassion for and act to help someone in need. We have opportunities every day to meet the needs of people we work for and among. It can be as simple as making sure a confused customer finds the right item for their need, or noticing that a new coworker needs help but is afraid to ask. James urges us to take special concern for those who are vulnerable or marginalized, and we may need to practice noticing who these people are at our places of work. This is the heart of the book of James. James does not imagine that works is at odds with faith. There can be no justification by works, because there can be no good works unless there is already faith, trust in God. James doesn't mean that faith can exist without works, yet be insufficient for salvation. What he means is that any faith that does not lead to works is dead. In other words, it is no faith at all. As the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead. James doesn't command Christians to work for the benefit of others in need instead of placing their faith in Christ, or even in addition to placing their faith in Christ. What James expects is that Christians will work for the benefit of others in need as a result of placing their faith in Christ. The insight that Christian faith always leads to practical actions is in itself a lesson for the workplace. We cannot divide the world into spiritual and practical, for the spiritual is the practical. You see that Abraham's faith was active along with his works. James says, therefore we can never say, I believe in Jesus and I go to church, but I keep my personal faith out of work. That kind of faith is dead. James's words, you see that a person is justified by works and not by faith alone, challenges us to work out our commitment to Christ in our daily activities. The rest of the letter of James gives practical applications of the two underlying principles of trusting God and working for the benefit of others in need. Given our assessment of James 2:14 through 26, our scriptures for today, we should proceed with the perspective that these applications are outworkings of faith in Christ, valid in James's day and valid in our world today as well. I opened a lesson this morning with scripture from the Gospel of Matthew that was actually found in a lesson that we had earlier this year that I recalled when I was preparing for this. And I felt that it fit very nicely into this. And in fact, it gives reinforcement from Jesus' teaching about the facts that we are to be doers and not only hearers of the word. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go visit you? And the king will reply, truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me. In the Beatitudes, Jesus blesses those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake and who are reviled for their faith. Likewise, Jesus' teachings on the blessings of the sheep comes after he has warned his disciples that they will be hated by the world and tortured for his sake. In Christ's kingdom, the blessed ones are those who do not retaliate with violence, but bear witness to a new empire by serving others. The blessed ones have demonstrated their faithfulness by performing acts of loving kindness, faith by works. The charge to care for the poor and the disadvantaged can be found throughout the scriptures, but it is especially exhibited in the ministry of Jesus. In this gospel, Christ has announced the arrival of God's kingdom while he cures the sick, welcomes the despised, and provides food for the hungry. He orders his disciples to carry on his ministry by doing likewise. The service of the least concerns all people everywhere. Since Jesus has warned the disciples repeatedly of their upcoming persecution, the context of this passage suggests that believers would certainly be among those who are suffering and who are going to be in prison. The primary purpose of prison at that time was not to incarcerate individuals for an indefinite period of time, but to have a place to hold them for trial. And it was often the responsibility of loved ones to provide some basic necessities while the person was in jail. Not only are believers to provide this service for one another, but they are to demonstrate Christ's love by ministering to others who may have no one to care for them at all. The righteous ones performed these deeds with no idea that they were ministering to Christ. Jesus says that whenever they gave food to the hungry, welcomed the stranger, clothed the naked, or visited the sick or in prison, they acted in kindness towards Jesus himself. Jesus can identify with the least of these because he has walked in their shoes. On the other hand, those who have failed to see the needs of the disadvantaged have acted as though they have never seen Jesus. They have not followed in Christ's footsteps. They have not continued to do the work that the Master has called them to do. They have not displayed who the real King is. Throughout the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus' teaching has announced and illustrated the kingdom of God. God's kingdom does not function like a typical kingdom. The divine reign has invaded the world and is good news, especially to those on the fringes of society. The rule welcomes those who have no status and seeks to serve others rather than to exploit them. The righteous have inherited the kingdom. Those who claim to follow Jesus and hope to endure to the end are called to live faithfully in God's righteous empire. So let's all be doers and not hearers of the word. Proverbs 19:1-17. Whoever is kind to the poor lends to the Lord, and he will reward them for what they have done. Amen. Phil, would you close us, please?
Church and as individuals, Father, help us to be your hands and feet in the world, that they might see Jesus and might come to him. We praise you and thank you.
What a night. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather have him than riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than fine houses, a great land. You see, I just want to be led by his name. Hard hands than to be a king of a vast domain than be held in sin's dreads way. Oh, I'd rather have
you to come happy for her.
I am.
Good morning. Birthdays and anniversaries today, and I think we have one right here. Hold on, anniversary over here. Paula has a birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Paula. Happy birthday to you. And many more, many more. And Ron and Tina has an anniversary. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you.
Mom's not here, but so when's our anniversary? April 1st.
So is that this week?
April 1st.
Oh.
Anniversary.
Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you.
Happy anniversary, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you. What is it? What's going on?
Our grandpa Papa has his 70th birthday.
Hey! Same. What's his name?
Freddie
Hickman. Where's Freddie? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Freddie. Happy birthday to you. Woo, woo, woo. Go on, Freddie. Go on, Freddie. Anybody else? Oh, my goodness. We got another one here. Freddie, I forgot your dollar.
Oh, yeah, I ain't got one.
I got you. Vicky? Birthday? Vicky has a birthday. Vicky has a birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Vicky. Happy birthday to you. Any more? That's it, preacher.
Will the Lord be with you? Let us pray. We use a lot of words, gracious God, but do little to turn them into deeds. Instead of being of one heart and soul, we choose sides and form groups of folks just like us. Blessed with great grace, we have trouble sharing it with those who need it most. Forgive us, love of God. Forgive us as we step out of our shadows into your light. Restore us as we reveal our brokenness. Hear us as we proclaim Jesus Christ as our Lord and our God. Let us confess our sins to the Lord in silence. And all of God's people said, amen. Well, let's stand and greet each other in the Lord, and then Phil's going to lead us in praise and worship.
Please take your seats. Please take your seats. Or actually, just you don't have to sit down, you got to stand up again. All right. All right. Go ahead and put the words up there, buddy. We're going to get rolling. Good morning. Let's stand together and worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's praise Him this morning. Let's sing to the Lord. Bless His holy name. Here we go. Praise Him. I will 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 praise Him. After Him this morning. Look to Jesus. Worship Him. As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after Thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship Thee. You alone are my strength, my shield. To You alone doth my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship Thee. As a deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after Thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship Thee. You alone are my
strength, my shield. To you alone doth my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee.
Amen, amen. Please be seated. And I'd like to welcome you to Andrew's Chapel, for we are a church of a risen Lord, and it is good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. 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 Announcements you have seen are scrolling on the screens up there. But what we're going to begin to do is highlight some of the missions and ministry that are going on in the church. So this morning we're going to highlight the Fun Committee, F-U-N. Come on, Nancy.
A new mission has started this year to increase fellowship among our members and friends of Andrew's Chapel. The mission consists of 3 to 4 events throughout the year, and where everyone, young and old, can come and participate. Our first event's coming up, a sing-along supper to be held on April 28th, beginning at 4:30 in the afternoon. So bring a dish with something in it, because John wants that, and or a finger dessert. Don't go overboard. It's not a fist Sunday. We don't want a lot of leftovers. We want clean up easy.
Go where the Lord leads you.
I'm sending it all home with you. For those of you who say, I don't think I can go because I can't sing. Remember that in Psalm 100, verses 1 and 2, we read that we should make a joyful noise unto the Lord. So come and have some fun. And that fun stands for Fellowship Uniting Neighbors.
Yes. Good job.
Thank you, Nancy. And I don't know if I should say this or not, but Nancy, you look fantastic, don't she? She does. You look great. You look fantastic. Thank you so much. Are there any announcements that haven't been mentioned that need to be brought to attention?
I would like to mention that tomorrow night we're having a VBS meeting, and there needs to be a changing of the guards, if you will. We need some fresh blood, some new meat. We need some young spirit. We need people to come and be excited. We're bringing up an army, and we need to make that army strong.
Amen. VBS meeting tomorrow night, 6:30. Just come, and we'll put you doing something. I guarantee it. But please be with us tomorrow night. Also, next Sunday is Shoebox Sunday. Ooh. Are you going to mention anything about that or no?
Just that, that we are going to gear up next week for our Shoebox Sunday, and that means we're kicking off our sponsor of Shoebox for $25 each, or 2 for $50. Yeah. But anyway, it is going to be good. We are going to talk a lot about the Shoebox Ministry. We're going to have some special entertainment from Pastor John. And but come, we're going to have a good time.
Davey, I think you should wear your craziest pair of shoes.
My craziest pair of shoes.
Yeah, okay, I can do that.
Davey, shoot. Well, praise the Lord. Was there anything else? Yes, Pam. Women's meeting tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock. Well, this time let's have children's church. Come on, kiddos.
All right, y'all, come on. It's okay. You can sit up there. You can sit down here with me. It doesn't make any difference. And this is what we do, girls. We always count to three. That's okay. Have you got them now? You still got hiccups now?
Yes.
Okay, we count to three and we say, good morning, Father. And then I'm going to say, what's God doing? We say, he's smiling. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3. Good morning, Father. And what's God doing?
Smiling.
Let me see your best smile. So pretty, so pretty. And the thing we do next is we always sing Jesus Loves Me, because we never want to forget that he loves us, okay? All right, y'all go.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones, they hear me low. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
That was so amazing. You know, I have hardly anything left after that. You did so good. I want to share with you that this morning we talked about the road to Emmaus. There were two disciples that were walking. This was happening the very day that Jesus was resurrected from the dead, when Jesus came back to life. His disciples were sad. They were discouraged. Some of them had not seen him yet. But these two disciples were walking along the road talking, and all of a sudden Jesus appeared walking with them. But they didn't recognize him. And he said, "What y'all talking about?" And they said, "Are you not from here? Do you not know all the things that have happened?" And Jesus then began to explain to them that all those things that happened, Jesus being wrongly convicted and hung on the cross and beaten, all that was the scripture being fulfilled. They talked about this for hundreds of years, and it was finally coming to pass, and it did come to pass. And it was a 7-mile walk from Jerusalem to Emmaus, 7 miles. So they got there. And Jesus acted like he was going to go on a little bit further. And they said, "Wait, why don't you come on in with us? You know, talk some more with us." They got in the house. And what did Jesus do?
He broke the bread and said, "It's my body."
Well, he broke the bread. He said, "It's my body," at the Passover. You are right about that. But he broke the bread. And what happened when he broke the bread? Say it again.
They recognized
who he was, because they had seen him do that before. That's when he reminded them, "Every time you do this, remember me." And what did they do? They remembered him. That's exactly right. And what happened then?
He just disappeared
out of their sight. And they were amazed, and they were going, "Oh my goodness, he walked with us and he talked with us." Were we not burning inside that Jesus was with us? I want you to burn inside every day knowing that Jesus is with you always. Okay? Say that. Jesus is with me always.
Jesus is with me always.
Amen. Okay, Pastor, come pray.
Well, let's pray. Father, are not our hearts burning inside? Father, I pray that our hearts will burn for you, Lord, for just a passion to proclaim your good news to this community. But Father, most of all, to the children in our care, that they hear the good news from the mouths of their parents and grandparents and aunts and uncles. Father, I pray a hedge of protection around each one. Lord, that they live a life full of your mercy and grace, Father, and be able to share it with others. Lord, I just pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. While the children are finding their way, let us stand and sing hymn number 102, "My Hope Is Built." Please stand.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. Darkness veils his lovely face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. one rock, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, thee then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found. Lest in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
Pray now that we affirm our faith through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty. Amen. Please be seated. Well, what a joy it is to see all these beautiful faces this morning. And what joy do you have? What joy or concern do you bring to the house of the Lord this morning?
Brother,
yes.
I've got a joy. My family surprised me. My grandchildren's here today. My daughter, my son-in-law, his parents, and we just blessed.
Amen. 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 Any other joys? Any concerns? Man, yeah. Oh, I'm sorry, Betty. You have to yell at me. Well, praise the Lord. I sure will. We definitely will. We definitely will. Are there any more? Yes, Emily? Hey. I saw another hand somewhere. Phil? Charlie. You sure will. Yes, Joyce. Oh, we sure will. Nancy?
I have a joy that there's always angels protecting us.
Amen. Amen.
Mm-hmm. They came out without even looking.
Amen. Are there any more? Yes, Pam. Amen. Amen. Allison. Amen. 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 She is a blessing. For the, oh, Teresa, go ahead. Well, I'm glad you're here this morning. Praise the Lord. And, yeah, Penny's back. Penny's back. Praise the Lord. And for those that most people here know, Jim Miller, Dumpy Jim, he was back in church this morning and looking well. So he was back. Praise the Lord. Well, Grant. Alinda Mears. Grant, will you come? You don't know what we get ready to do, do you? All right. Phil, will you grab the snakes? The Bible says that if you're in need of prayer, to come forward to be anointed and lay hands on you, pray for you. That's what we're going to do to you this morning. Nothing crazy. We just do what the Bible says to do. So Grant, in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, I lift you up to the Lord. Father, I lift up my new friend and brother to you. Lord, I just pray for safe passage home. Lord, that he get home safely. Lord, that you protect him the whole way. And Lord, I lift up his wrist to you, Lord, that healing continue to take place. Lord, that you lead and guide the doctors and the physicians that are in his, taking care of him. Lord, that he be 100% in no time. And Lord, all of this to your glory. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen. Baby Charlie, all right. Feel the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. I lift you up to the Lord. Father, I lift Phil up to you as he stands here for Charlie. Lord, I just pray for healing for Charlie, for his little lungs to be full of just fresh air and, Lord, your breath breathe inside of him, the healness and the wholeness and just healing take place in his body. And Lord, I just pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Thank you.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Any more? Well, Warren, will you lift up the prayers of the people this morning?
Heavenly Father, we praise you and we thank you for this day. We thank you for watching over us. And we thank you for your healing powers that we know is always there. We ask you, Lord, to be with us and guide us and lead us in the days ahead. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
God is good
all the time.
This time we receive our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Father, I lift these offerings to you. Lord, I pray that you'll lead and guide us on how to use them, that other people in this community will be able to see the love of Jesus Christ through the ministry that you've called us to. Lord, I pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please be seated.
Morning, everybody. Well, first of all, I promise I'm not going to talk about Shoebox Ministry. Okay, so, but I do want to tell you about something special, or should I say someone special. Today, we learned that Freddie is having a birthday this week. Everybody give him a hand. So today, Freddie, we're doing something a little special for you today. For years, Freddie has blessed us with his infectious smile and laugh, his kind soul, and just his gentle spirit. I think we can all agree that not only do we love to hear Freddie sing, we love to watch him sing. Right? I will tell you a true story. Several times, people have come up to me, newbies in the church, after church, and said, "Who is that fella that stands in the back row and sings with such conviction and sounds so beautifully?" Well, instantly, I knew it was not Pastor John. But I realized, I said, that is our dear, sweet Freddie. And Freddie, we love you so. And we appreciate you singing in the choir for all these many years. We appreciate you doing early morning, the praise and worship with Pastor Phil, the dynamic duo. And today we have something special for you. Your granddaughters are not only going to sing for us, but they're going to sing for you. So today, right now, I would like to introduce Shelby. Shelby, come on up, and let's give her a round of applause, everybody.
Jesus, I heard you had a big house where I could have a room of my own. And Jesus, I heard you had a big yard, big enough to let a kid roam. I give you my heart, then you let me go there. And Jesus, I heard about mealtime when all your children come to eat. I heard you have a great meal. Have his own seat. And Jesus, they said that there'd be plenty of good things in heaven to share. And Jesus, I just like to tell you, well, I sure would love to go there. And Jesus, I heard in your big house there's plenty of love to go around. I heard there's always singing. sure must love me a lot. And Jesus, I just like to tell you, well, I sure do love you a lot.
I'd like to introduce Asbury. She also has a song for her papa.
I am a promise. I am a possibility. I am a promise with a capital P. I am a great big bundle of potentiality. And I am learning to hear God's voice. Yes, I am trying to make the right choice. Yes, I'm a promise to be anything God wants me to be. I can go anywhere that He wants me to go. I can be anything that He wants me to be. I can climb the high mountains. I can cross the wide seas. I am a great big promise, you see. I am a promise. I am a possibility. I am a promise with a capital P. I am a great big bundle of potentiality. And I am learning to hear God's voice. Yes, I am trying to make the right choice. Yes, I'm a promise to be anything God wants me to be.
Good job.
How do you follow that? Our scripture lesson this morning is found in the book of Acts, chapter 4, verses 32 through 37. If you're following along in the Pew Bible, you can find it on page 148 in the New Testaments, or you can also follow along on the monitors. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we praise you and we thank you for this day. We thank you, Father, for the words I'm about to read, your words, Father. May they be used to enrich our lives so we may enrich the lives of others. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. Would you please stand for the scripture reading? Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. There was a Levite from Cyprus, Joseph, to whom the apostles gave the name Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He sold the field that belonged to him, then brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. The word of God for the people of God. Please be seated.
I told you guys when first time I came to this church, I went home and I told Sammy, I said I may start going to church, but it won't be that one, right? I've told you guys that. Well, it was sometime later. She told me, she said, well, they're getting a new pastor. because this time Phil wasn't the pastor and it was someone else. She said, "We're getting a new pastor." I said, "You getting a new pastor?" She said, "Yeah." I said, "Well, who is it?" She said, "Well, it's the guy, it's Phil, the guy in the choir." I said, "The guy in the choir?" Because I thought they were talking about Freddie. There was a great man who told his followers, there are two things in life that matter above all else. Integrity. If you made a promise, you carry it out. Even if it bankrupts you, even if it cripples you, even if it kills you, if you made a promise, you keep it. And the second thing is common sense, like not making that kind of promise. Integrity, right? Do what you say you're going to do. Do all the good you can. By all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. John Wesley. Generosity. Generosity and integrity. Christian character to go with our Christian profession. I'd like to look at Barnabas. Barnabas is a wonderful example of Christian character. His gift of generosity is mentioned in Acts 4 as he's introduced to us for the first time in the Bible. Now, what do we know about Barnabas? Well, it's interesting to know that his real name is Joseph. That he must have been a larger-than-life character for him to have gotten the name Barnabas, because that means son of encouragement. You know, it comes from the root word that Jesus used when he's talking about the Holy Spirit, which is comforter. So Barnabas provided help and encouragement and comfort and wisdom to those around him. He was a Jew from the tribe of Levi. He was a native of the island of Cyprus. And he played an important role in two churches, the Church of Jerusalem, which was the mother church, the big church, and then there was the church in Antioch, which was the missionary church, the church which they sent forth. Now, Barnabas was a man with a big heart. He was a generous man. Here in our reading for the book of Acts, we read of him selling off land, presumably in Cyprus, from where he had came from, to help support those in the church. We see Barnabas' generous heart as he helps the church in Jerusalem see that Paul really had been converted. And in Acts 9, here's the story. It says, when Paul came to Jerusalem, he tried to join the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he really was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. He told him how Saul was on a journey, had seen the Lord, and that the Lord had spoken to him, and how in Damascus he had preached fiercely in the name of Jesus. So Saul stayed with them and moved about freely in Jerusalem, speaking boldly in the name of the Lord. What a generous heart Barnabas had to be willing to spend that time with Saul, soon to be Paul. Barnabas was a man of integrity. In Acts 11, it says this. It says, some of the followers from Cyprus and Cyrene went to Antioch and started telling Gentiles the good news about the Lord Jesus. The Lord's power was with them, and many people turned to the Lord and put their faith in him. News of what was happening reached the church in Jerusalem. Then they sent Barnabas to Antioch. Then Barnabas got there and saw that God had been kind enough for them, had been kind to them. He was very glad. So he begged them to remain faithful to the Lord with all their hearts. Barnabas was a good man of great faith, and he was filled with the Holy Spirit. Many more people turned to the Lord. I believe that Barnabas was effective in proclaiming the good news of Jesus because he not only taught the talk, but he walked the walk. We live in an age where people are very skeptical of Christianity, of church, Christians. Very skeptical of us. Our reputation outside of the church is not good. Okay, the world is not in love with us. We have a reputation of hating people. Of pushing people away. That's our reputation to the world. Church needs more Barnabases. They need more people like him, men and women who have integrity in their lives. The quality of being honest and having strong moral principles. Honesty, uprightness, honor, righteousness, morality, right-mindedness, fairness, truthfulness. All those things are Christian character. It was Emerson who once said, "Who you are, speak so loudly, I can hear, I can't hear what you're saying." Who you are, speak so loudly, I can't hear what you're saying. You ever met anybody like that? Personality is so strong, who they are, that it just overpowers anything that they may have to say. Barnabas was a man who could see the potentials in others and was prepared to develop it. In Acts 11, Barnabas went to Taurus to look for Saul, and when he found him, he brought him to Antioch. So for the whole year, Barnabas and Saul met with the church and taught great numbers of people. The disciples were called Christians first at Antioch. Barnabas didn't just see Paul's potential, he did something about it. He put his beliefs into action and went and got him for ministry. My job, you know, Phil has told me many years ago, he said, your job is to work yourself out of a job. Is to find somebody else to do all the stuff you're doing, is to work yourself out of a job. Is to see potential in people and try to direct them that way. So that's my job, along with a lot of other people here. It's your jobs too. But when we see people that are gifted in certain areas, it's our job to encourage them to pursue that, to go forward. I had a wonderful Christian person that just a couple of weeks ago that they're so gifted, so wonderful, and they were apprehensive because I'm asking them to use their gifts. And what I want to explain to them more than anything else is it's not yours. It's not yours to hoard. It's not yours to keep. It's not yours to, well, I don't want to feel like it. It's not up to you. It's for you to use that gift for the glorifying of God. It has nothing to do with you. I know you want it to, but it doesn't. It's God's gift. It's God's people, and you are to do God's work. It has very little room for you. It's all God's. You know, we worry, this is all free stuff here, we worry so much about tithing 10%. Can I tell you, that's Old Testament thinking. There is no more 10%. All y'all are out. No more 10% tithing. You know what it is now? 100%. Everything. Everything you got belongs to God, including your gifts. Everything. He didn't just see Paul's potential, but he did something about it. You see the similar thing with Mark, the gospel writer Mark. Paul couldn't see Mark's potential. I think Paul saw Mark as undependable because Mark had dropped out of the first missionary trip. When things got hot, things got a little tough, Mark left. Barnabas saw that if he invested time in Mark, there was potential in him. I want to read you the story of what happened. It's in Acts 15. It says, sometime later, Paul said to Barnabas, let's go back and visit the believers in all the towns where we preached the word of the Lord and see how they were doing. Barnabas wanted to take John, also called Mark, with them. But Paul did not think it wise to take him because he had deserted them in Pamphylia and was not to continue with them in their work. They had such a sharp disagreement that they parted company. Barnabas took Mark and sailed to Cyprus. Paul took Silas and left, commended by the believers to the grace of the Lord. He went through Cyprus and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. So Barnabas takes Mark and leaves. And Paul takes Silas and leaves. Barnabas still sees the potential. Even though Mark had floundered and failed, it's okay. He stood by him. He encouraged him. And what's so fascinating about this whole story is the very last letter that Paul writes. In the very end of it, this is what he says. He says, do your best to come to me quickly. For Demas, because he loved the world, has deserted me and has gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia and Titus has gone to Malta. Only Luke is with me. Get Mark and bring him with you, because he is helpful to me in my ministry. So here's a guy that Paul had kind of bailed out on. It kind of like, you know, he ain't going with us. That guy quit on us first time. But here he is locked up his last days. And who does he ask for? The guy that Barnabas saw potential in the whole time. Send Mark. Send Mark. encouragement, and seeing potential in other people. Paul had this single-minded going after the mission trip that he failed him, that he failed everything. But Barnabas had faith in his nephew. God had not given up on John Mark, and he did not give up on Barnabas. It is a timely reminder that the church needs both the single-mindedness of Paul and the generous spirit of Barnabas. We have to have this focus in church. You know, we have to have this focus in church that we keep on keeping on. Our job in this church is to keep going. Keep going, no matter what, no matter what happens, we keep pressing forward. And we need that in church. We need that single-minded vision going forward, going straight. We needed that Paul aspect of who we are, but we also need Barnabas. It's not an either or, it's a both and. We need to be generous, and we need to be single-minded and straightforward. It's one thing that I can hold as a testimony to this church and what it means to move forward. Our early service is fantastic. And I'm not saying that because y'all all here and you weren't there. But I'm just saying it really is, it's a thing all to itself, is it not, Freddie? And it's just starting to grow and it's starting to flower, and it is absolutely beautiful. As we sing bluegrass gospel hymns, man, it's amazing. It is amazing to see that. But what that is, that whole thing is God's determined to carry us where we needed to go. Man, we could have stopped. COVID hit, we could have said, man, I ain't doing this. You know, when we were doing five or six people at early worship and just struggling to get through, but we keep staying the course, and that's what we have to do with the church. Stay the course. Don't stop. Keep on. Keep on. You stumble and fall, you get back up. You stumble and fall, you get back up. But you keep the faith and you keep on going. That's what church is. That's what the faith walk is. Man, if we quit every time we stumble, we won't go anywhere. All that was free. Barnabas was a man prepared to stand his ground for what he saw was right. When we're reading Acts 15, it's Paul and Barnabas. You'll notice that the writer is saying Paul and Barnabas had a sharp disagreement as they parted. Now, I'm not sure if you'd want to pick a fight with Paul, because he was a pretty good debater, but you know, Barnabas, he can hold his own, and he stood for what was right, regardless whether or not Paul liked it or not. Sometimes in our Christian faith, we have to stand for what is right, whether the world likes it or not. You know, when we made this big switch, when we switched from who we were at the UMC to who we are at the GMC, did you think that the world was going to stand around and applaud us on? Oh, yeah, you guys are doing the right thing. Go ahead. No, they did not. The world looks at us, well, we should have stayed where we were. But we have to keep on. We have to keep pushing forward. We have to stand up for what we believe. Finally, Barnabas is a type that wasn't threatened by the gifts of others. If you'll notice in the writings, as it's going through the book of Acts, it starts off Barnabas and Paul. It's the way the writer is writing it down. And that writing is important during this time. So he's writing it down, Barnabas and Paul. But as you travel through the book, and you actually get to chapter 15 of verse 42, and it actually switches to Paul and Barnabas. So what does that tell you? It tells you that leadership has changed. And you might think that that's just simple because it's writing. But early writers, that meant something. And it meant that the leadership had changed from Barnabas to Paul. But if you'll notice, Barnabas never has a problem with it. He accepts it. He accepts his position. He's not sitting on his position like he has all this authority and power. He's understanding that it's all about Jesus. And if we'll do that, church, if we'll understand that it's all about Jesus and not about you, we'll be better off. And Barnabas understood that, you know, it's not about who's in charge, because Jesus is in charge. I'd like to sum up the traits of Barnabas. He was a man with a big heart. He was a generous man, a man of integrity. He's a man that could see the potential of others and develop it. And he was prepared to stand his ground for what is right. And finally, Barnabas was not the type to feel threatened by other people's gifts. Church, we still need men and women who have a Barnabas heart. We need Barnabas' gifts as well as Paul's, as we're going to continue to effectively preach the gospel in our increasingly post-Christian generation. We need Barnabas out there. You know, we sing a song in this church, and we've sang it in the church I grew up in. All of you are very familiar with the song. But there's a verse to it that we never sing. All we ever sing is the chorus. But there's a verse to it, and I want to read it to you. If there ever were dreams that were lofty and noble, they were my dreams at the start. And hope for life's best were the hopes that I harbor deep down in my heart. But my dreams turned to ashes and my castles all crumbled. My fortune turned to loss. So I wrapped it all in the rags of life and I laid it at the cross. Something beautiful. Something good. All my confusion, he understood. All I had to offer him was brokenness and strife. But he made something beautiful of my life. You know, I started coming to this church 19 years ago. Well, actually 20, but 19 before I got stuck. And I was so lost and so broken when I walked in this church. I mean, I was. My life was unraveling. And I met men and women in this church that changed me. I remember Mr. Elbert, Uncle Elbert. He's the reason I always came back. It wasn't Freddie or Phil. A little old man named Mr. Elbert, and he used to sit right up here. I didn't know him when he had the velvet voice and the singing. I didn't know any of that. Only thing I knew about Mr. Elbert is that he would look at me every Sunday and say, "Son, I love you." And he meant it. I think about people, Mal Workman in this congregation. I think about Phil, who saw potential and did something about it. You see, I was broken. But through good men of integrity and honesty and truthfulness, God was able to make something beautiful of my life. And he can do the same for you. And all of God's people said, amen. Let us pray. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right to give you our thanks and praise, O God, for you have raised Jesus Christ from the dead, and by your grace we have life in his name. From the very beginning, the word of life was with you, creating everything in earth and heaven. You rescued your people from death and called them to follow you, walking in the light. We gave you thanks with those who went before us, with saints and martyrs, evangelists and prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You sent your word of life into the world and your Son, Jesus, shining your light into darkness that the sins of the world might be forgiven. Though he was killed by those who walked in darkness, you raised him to resurrection life, and now he lives at your side forever. Advocate mercy for all who stumble into sin. Through his great grace, we are able to live in fellowship with you and in peace with one another in one heart and mind. On the night which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, on these gifts of bread and wine. make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. For those who are willing to serve, please come. I think you got two there. The table is open for all who wish to receive.
Wow. What a night. I'd rather have Jesus and silver or gold. I'd rather have him than riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than fine houses or great land. You see, I just want to be led by his nail-scarred hands, than to be a king of a vast domain, than be have Jesus more than anything that this old crazy world can afford me today.
Best for a world of lost sinners.
Praise the Lord. Wheels came all the way off of that one, huh? Amen. Amen. You know, what a wonderful problem to have. What a problem to have. So if you're here this morning, I wanted a few minutes, but that got stolen. Freddie, thank you. Thank you. This isn't all about you today. It's about Jesus. But I can say thank you for the work that Jesus has done through you in my life. God bless you. So. If you're here this morning and you would like prayer, then please come. Please come as we stand and sing our closing hymn.
Something beautiful, something good, all my confusion, he understands.
tried, but he made something beautiful of my life. Something beautiful, something good. All my confusion, he understood. All I had to offer him was brokenness and strife, but he made something beautiful of my life.
Father, I lift this congregation to you. Father, I pray that you'll lead and guide him this week, that you'll place him in the path of people who don't know you. Lord, I pray you see everyone safely home and safe to return. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand.